Это штука, что для меня записывание, она не для увеличения звука.
Это что надо писать в звук.
Ага. А так я должен громко говорить.
Понял.
На доске. Могу и на слайдах, если кому-то сильно хочется. Мне кажется, в прошлый раз кто-то просил, чтобы я не делал слайдов как-то так. У меня какое-то такое слабое воспоминание. Не-не. Я совершенно... Окей. So, should I start now, or we're waiting for some announcement or something? Very good. Thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here, and I will speak about Heyer-Teichmuller spaces. And the problem with Heyer-Teichmuller spaces is that nobody really, there's no clear definition. So I would start with character varieties. So suppose you have, so typically I will always assume that our base is a compact Riemannian surface. Oriented, obviously. Вот, okay, that's not, for most of what I will be telling, it's, I mean, you can do it for other Keller manifolds, but nobody cares that much. So there's almost very little research on what happens in higher dimension. Okay, now we have a group, which is typically real group, real Lie group. And you consider the character variety, which is, well, maps homomorphisms from irreducible homomorphisms. So I will write it like this, from pi 1 of m to g, quotient by action of g. Questions, comments? I don't know if the convention on irreducibility, but I think it's standard. So the basic example is a PSL to R. So let's, this is example of how you can obtain Teichmuller space from as a component of character variety. You consider G is PSL to R, which is the same as SO1, 2. And this is the same as automorphisms, isometries, like oriented isometries, plus of hyperbolic space. Should I explain this? Okay, thanks. Now if you have a group, compact Riemannian surface, you can uniformize it. So M is a quotient of, we put up to conformal equivalence, M admits a unique, well, after a conformal change, M admits a unique metric of constant curvature, so it's represented as H quotient by pi 1 gamma, where gamma is pi 1 of M, and it acts by isometries on H. But this is the same group. So this gives a representation from pi 1 of M to isometries of which is as PSL to R. Okay, it turns out there is a whole component of the character variety which consists of such representations, and it is called Teichmuller components or Hitchin component, but Hitchin components are defined in more in bigger generality. Okay, so let's, there are several different ways to describe this component. So first I want to notice that if you have the character variety is the same as irreducible. So character variety is the same as irreducible flat G bundles, which means that it's principal G bundles with action. In fact, you can drop PN, do just a sale. in this case it will be the same. So it's reducible flat G bundles, flat in the sense that we have the principal bundle which has principal bundle connection which is flat, and local monodromy is trivial. But then what happens is that you can, so this gives, I mean, SA2R bundle is the same as rank 2 bundles, so SL2R bundles are the same as rank 2 vector bundles, vector, real vector bundles with fixed determinant, so it's fixed determinant. Okay, and in that situation you can actually find particular, describe this particular component very explicitly. I mean, there are many components, but the Techmuller, the Hitchin component, is described explicitly as follows. You have, so this is a flat SL2R bundle, but SL2R homotopically is S1. And so it's it gives a flat S1 bundle, and flat S1 bundles has a canonical invariant called, I think, Milner-Moore invariant. But anyway, it's just Euler characteristic. So you associate with S1 bundle a two-dimensional real bundle. And its Euler characteristic is less than or equal than, I think, G. So this Euler characteristic. G minus 1, maybe? This is flat, and then you can reduce it to a locally, it's locally trivial bundle, then you just reduce everything using polar decomposition. Anyway, there is such a number, and this number is, when it is maximal, it's the Techmuller component. So then the people realize that there are special interesting components in character varieties which no, because it's okay. It's locally trivial. Locally trivial. I'm sorry. You were right, and I'm. So the idea is that you have a flat flat two-dimensional bundle which without this two-dimensional bundle, in fact. Without a metric. There is no canonical metric. And the chain-Weyl formulas which compute your characteristic classes through the curvature don't work for Euler class. Because for Euler you need to be orthogonal connection. Thank you very much. It's really something I had to be more precise. So you have this just two-dimensional flat bundle associated with this, and you compute its Euler characteristic, and you find that it satisfies this inequality, which is tricky but very important. And when it's maximal, when it is not maximal, there is a theorem by Goldman, which says that. I'm not sure if it works in all components, but probably it works. Anyway, it works for sufficiently many components. No, I think it works for all. So if for non-Techmuller component of this character variety of character MG SL2R, probably even PSL, the mapping class group, so acts ergodically. And of course, on Techmuller space, it acts in a standard way properly. So this is a certain distinction between two kinds of components of character variety. Well, this is topological invariant. So there are clearly distinct two-dimensional bundles giving you different topological invariant. For bigger dimension, it's harder because there could be more. Yeah, it's connected components. Sorry. It's just you have this several disconnected moduli space of vector bundles. If it is complex, there is just one, but we speak of real. For real case, and typically they are not compact, like Teichmuller space, right? Okay. Maximum. Yeah. And the whole business is about how you do that for bigger rank. So we don't, you fix the Riemann surface, and you, or genus is, there are different situations for different genus, but the most drastic changes occur when you change the group. Okay, so the higher Teichmuller space, which is not well defined, so higher Teichmuller is the same as Hitchin component of character variety. Hitchin component is not, well, it is obvious, it's sort of defined for most groups, but not for all. It's not entirely understood. There is a intrinsic definition, but it's not clear which one is which. And I won't tell you precisely because nobody knows what is precisely, but probably you have heard lots of lectures about Lyapunov constants. So one of the definitions, which is not, so if you have Hitchin, this implies, and more or less the opposite is not entirely true, but almost always true, there's almost no counterexamples, that Hitchin implies that mapping class group acts properly. And it's, so this is why people are interested in that. They want to find new varieties with mapping class group action, yeah? Okay. And so the idea is the following. Consider your curve, Riemann surface, and let's go through the geodesics and take a frame. You take a frame, you move it around, you come back. In some, by Poincaré return theorem, you would come back at some point, definitely, if you go by geodesic. And then you can connect your new point, which is close to old one, and the old one, and you look at the corresponding translation matrix. And the eigenvalues of this translation matrix tend to a limit, which is called Lyapunov constants. And this Hitchin is representation is also called Anosov representations. Because they're representations where these constants, Lyapunov constants, go to something which is bigger than one and less than one. There is no, they are even bigger or less. There's typically you would have a number of constants parameterizing certain even matrix, upper triangular, and there all these numbers should be not equal to one in absolute value. Of the limit. It's something I'm not prepared enough to talk, and in fact the specialists, they're not definitely sure what happens. So if you look at the canonical definition of Anosov, it's not like that. But I think for when you have hyperbolic space, this is pretty much equivalent. What I wanted to tell about different things, so there's an idea of Fock. Yes? How to define it? Well, for PSL, there's just one, and this is the one where mapping class group acts properly. For not PSL, I'm not going to do it. PCL and R is sufficient for our purposes. Because this is where Fock's approach works. There's this, I think, either N or N by 2 components for PSL and R, and we're interested in one where mapping class group acts properly, at least without all dense orbits. But in fact, you can, there are topological invariants similar to this Milner-Wood invariant, and you can use it to define it better way. I'm not sufficiently specialist to explain it fast, at least. So I wanted to give you another definition of Heyerdahl-Müller, which is due to Fock, and it is quite amazing, especially because nothing is proven yet about it. Except that Fock compute, Fock and Thomas, so it's Vladimir Fock, and Alex Thomas, who gave this definition in their paper, which is an archive. Okay. Yeah, before I start, maybe I should do a couple of more words for motivation. So let's look at the following Heyerdahl-Müller space, which is the, one of the Heyerdahl-Müller components is just projective structures on your Riemann surface. So your Riemann surface M is a quotient of some subset, which is no longer upper half plane, some subset, but it, typically it's convex. So it's U inside CP1 quotient by some gamma. Now gamma acts, well, as it always did, by Möbius transport, by Möbius. This is projective structure on a curve. And the projective structures on a curve are should be also a Teichmuller space, but this is more or less the same as character variety for PSL 2C. Not quite, but close enough to try to identify them. And this is the next higher Teichmuller space understood explicitly as the set of projective structures on a curve. The higher up guys are completely mysterious so far. But the idea of Fock that how you do this, I mean, how you can understand this, this is the, to fix this structure, you fix not only a complex structure, but you fix a one jet of a disk. So the idea was you have to fix higher jets of a disk at each point, and this would give you the higher Teichmuller spaces. Now I would do formal definition of Fock, which it's not clear that it generalizes the projective structures, but it's almost there. Okay, so define Hilbert of Cn, of C2, sorry, Hilbert n, 0. It's a set of ideals. I write 0 here because I want these ideals to be supported in 0. So it's ideals in the space of germs. And codimension of I is n. This is a bit of a Hilbert scheme. Unlike the whole Hilbert scheme, which takes some expertise to define, this is part of a Grassmann. So it's sort of clear how you define complex structure on it, and it's clearly fine dimensional and so on. Should I repeat what I do? So it's ideals. You can think of in OCN, in holomorphic functions, supported in 0. So this is, I'm just explaining what is this space. Okay, now we are interested in C2, which is obtained as a complexification. So we fix the real structure. So we obtain C2, which is VR, real space, R2 times C. And it has tau from C2 to C2, anti-complex involution, so it's real structure. Just you take all coordinates and take complex conjugate. Now we're interested in non-degenerate locus in that space. So I, inside the point in the Hilbert scheme, and a zero of C2 called non-degenerate if I plus I bar, and by I bar I mean tau of I. I can write tau of I or I bar as you like. It's that complex conjugate to this ideal, and it should be maximal ideal of zero. So let me give you an example. This is the easiest example. So Hilb 1 is just a point. It's not interesting. So we're more interested in Hilb 2. Hilb 2, and I claim that Hilb 2, 0 of C2 is CP1. So this is because if you want to because you have so your I now contains the square of maximal ideal, and it is contained in maximal ideal, and the quotient is m by m zero square is just a tangent space. Tau tangent in zero on C2. And this is a line. I mean, you fix a line, and this is the same as fixing CP1. I hope I didn't mess it up. Okay, now we define, how you define complex structure? Of course, there are several different ways to define complex structure. We are interested in the following way. You have Tm to Tm, operator I or ji, I square is minus 1. So for, it's not obvious, but this is the same as to fix a complex structure for Riemann surface. So you define T10 as a set of all V such that I of V is equal to square of minus 1 V. Or T01 is better. So now have minus. And then you define holomorphic functions as functions which, if you differentiate them along 0, 1 vectors, you obtain 0. So F holomorphic, if and only if, a derivative along T01 of F is 0. And this, of course, your complex rotational coordinates. So if you fix this operator, this is the same as fixing your sheaf of holomorphic functions. And this is pretty much the same as coordinates. So I will define now this higher complex structures, just generalizing this linear algebraic approach. So linear algebraic approach means that you fix certain tensor in each tangent space, and then you use these tensors to define your the space of complex structures. Now, instead of a tensor, you fix another object. So let's define this X. It's a set of all, for each X inside M, fix, it's Xn, fix, IN I inside Hilb. Now we take we fix I inside Hilb N, and then we take tangent space in X of M and complexify it by multiplying by C. And here we write 0, and here we write non-degenerate. So at each point you fix this generalized complex structure operator, which is a non-degenerate point in the Hilbert scheme. So we do it smoothly on X. Should I repeat? Is it entirely clear to everybody? Please ask questions. I really appreciate when people ask questions instead of... Because it is complex structure for dimension one, right? For second Hilbert scheme. So it's higher complex structure. It's not me, it's Fock. Sort of. I didn't define yet the complex structure. I just defined this space. Let me define the complex structure, and then it becomes clear. Roma is right. Yeah. Yeah. I didn't finish the definition, but I want everybody to understand what is this Xn. That's, and then I will define the generalized complex structure using this Xn. Okay. It was cotangent here. This is important because now we have a group. Let's call it, this G pretty. It's Hamiltonian automorphisms of cotangent space, fixing zero section. And then you define complex the nth complex structure, the higher complex structure of degree. Should be, the numbering is bad. I should shift it, but I always, I mean, we start with 2, and 2 is usual complex structure, so it's 2n minus 2 probably. It is equal to x, this xn quotient by g. And this is the generalized complex structure on m. I mean, sorry, higher complex structure of nth higher complex structure on n minus 2 higher complex structure on M. So it is not, it's not enough to fix this jet. You have also identified jets which are related by global Hamiltonian automorphism.
Can you finish
I've thought that it is inherent here somewhere, but now I tried to explain it, it is just empty. I think I'm missing something here, but I can't improvise next to the blackboard, sorry. But you can do it, it's an exercise for everybody, it should be obvious. It is obvious unless you are here. Sorry. Yeah, so last time I checked it, it was there, it was more or less this. Okay, right, thanks. You're completely right. Let me do it. I can do it, it's not hard. So the idea is that instead of fixing the complex structure, so I inside, so it maps from Rn 2n to R2n, instead of that, you can fix a half-dimensional subspace. The eigenspace, let's call it So let's call it V, and let's call it this eigenspace V1, 0. It belongs to V times C. Its dimension half. It will be a posterior, it will be eigenspace of I, but I didn't yet define I. I will explain how to use this to define I. And then the assumption is that V1, 0 is intersected with V1, 0 bar, which we call V0, 1, is empty. Now we write the following operator, I, which is equal to one restricted to V1, 0 is equal to square of minus 1, and I restricted to V0, 1 is minus square of minus 1. And so it is written by a matrix of form. Square of minus 1, a square of minus 1, and then minus square of minus 1, dot minus square of minus 1, this kind of block matrix. This operator is real because these two guys are exchanged by a complex structure. And this operator has square minus 1. So it is an almost complex, it's a complex structure operator on V. And all of them are obtained this way. So if you have a subspace, half dimension, which has this property, it gives you a complex structure. And conversely, if you have a complex structure, it's given by such a subspace. Now we have a subspace here, which is in point in CP1. Our condition is that it is I. So our condition, which is non-degeneracy condition, is I. Wow, I again. Let's rename it to something like to P. So it's P. Our condition is that P intersected with P bar is equal everything. So it's a maximal ideal. But this is precisely the same as this condition. Plus, thank you, yes, thank you, of course. So this non-degenerate part of Hilbert scheme is precisely complex structures. That's linear algebra. Yeah, so if I understand Roma correctly, this thing should be a germ of a curve in the cotangent space, right?
No.
complexification, yeah, but okay, you're right. But anyway, we really need this Hamiltonian group action, otherwise somehow it stops working in bigger dimension because the dimension becomes infinite. It acts on the total space of cotangent space. And then it acts on Hilbert schemes inside. So we think of this guy as of a Hilbert scheme, but in direction of cotangent, in cotangent direction. And the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphism, it should act trivially on M, but it has freedom to act in the fibers, and it moves your Hilbert scheme around inside the cotangent space. So this is, the Hilbert scheme is situated, I have erased it, but it sits inside the, in each fiber of the cotangent space, you fix a Hilbert scheme. Should I put that back? So, oh, it doesn't act, just trivial. Because it's linear, and we know that it's Hamiltonian automorphisms, and they act trivially on the base, so they act trivially on the normal space to on the tangent space to a fiber, because it acts trivially on the normal space to a fiber. And normal space to a fiber is tangent space to M, and we know that it acts trivially on M. So it just doesn't act in dimension. Thank you very much, it was a good question. I can write, put this X curly back if anybody needs. Or I can go on. What should I do? It's not me, it's Fock and Thomas, and they compute dimensions. They compute dimensions at some point. They want that to be, at least dimension-wise, to be the same as the higher Tachmuller space, which we defined as Tachmuller Hitchin component in SL2 NR representations. They prove it, they counter the dimensions. At least this works. I didn't write, still it's infinite dimensional. So the corresponding higher Tachmuller space in the sense of Fock is this comp and quotient by isotopy of the group, so div zero of M. This is fine dimensional. The other guys, of course, infinite dimensional because the complex structures are infinite dimensional. No, I define this as a space of section of this bundle. So there is the space of section is infinite dimensional. Yeah. So the theorem of Fock and Thomas, the dimension of this Techen is the same as dimension of Techmuller component, probably all components. In character variety of pi 1 of M with SL N, we start with 2, so it's N N R, right? N plus 2 R. They computed just the dimension. That's more or less all they have. What is this dimension? I don't know. It's in this paper, definitely. But you can do it. I mean, okay, you have, the group is almost free. It has only one relation. So the dimension of is like SL and PSL. PSL and R times 2G minus 2. Minus one because you have one relation, and then you take one less to signify that you take a quotient by your group. So you dimension something like 2g minus 4 times n square minus 1. It's not very helpful. And also, of course, some of this dimension count is bad and have to be fixed because some of this action is trivial. So I'm sure we missed at least one. But the growth is like that. Okay. So now let me state Fock's conjecture. I defined you the, it was mostly motivation for conjecture because I'm not sure he really has like explanation why this Techmuller space would help much when you study this complex character variety. But in his mind it's clearly related. So you have the character variety, so conjecture. You have character variety for the group, again, M with the group P, S, L, and 2C. As I will tell you in a few minutes, how much time do I have, by the way? 10 minutes? 40, good. I have plenty of time. So I will tell you why this variety contains Techmuller space. So it contains Techmuller space in a natural way. So this is character variety for M. So it maps from P1 of M to a PSL. So which Techmuller space of M, of course? Should I write M here?
There is no N on the vector.
PSL 2C.
So nothing to do with this M?
Nothing. I told you, this was only motivation. No, it's just one N, 2. N equal 2 here. And this complex Lie group. So, of course, I told you that's the same as sort of quote unquote. It's Techmuller of M. I will tell you, it's not hard, it's easy. It's a usual Techmuller, usual Techmuller. M at the Riemann surface. Once and for all, it's fixed. Compact Riemann surface of genus 2 or more. So it's compact hyperbolic Riemann surface. Anyway, so this has dimension half of that. I will explain this. And the conjecture, yeah, and this is also hyperkeller. And this sits there as something which is Lagrangian inside hyperkeller. And the conjecture was that this hyperkeller structure, on this character variety, let's call it X, is independent. So, but this hyperkeller structure was obtained by Hitchin and then other people, but it is always dependent on the choice of complex structure on M, on our Riemann surface. And conjecture that it is independent on complex structure on M in a neighborhood of Teich inside X. So this should be something like a higher Teich-Muller space encompassing the usual Teich-Muller space in a hypercalor way. And in fact, this so consider a hypercalor structure on X, which is obtained by Hitchin from Hitchin vibrations. Then it should be independent on the complex structure on M in the neighborhood of Teich-Muller. This is something which was sort of not obliquely stated in a recent paper by Trautmann. So it's an archive, and the author, I don't remember the number from archive, but I can write the name, and you can try to read it. Trautwein, sorry. But it's not very geometrical, and what I wanted to tell you is how to interpret this in a geometric way without a proof, and the proof is, so it's not really about the proof. It's so the story is that we had a proof at some point. I'm not sure if it was okay or not, because it was me with Biswas and Mahan Mzh. Mitra, in fact, but the proof we didn't look at it because Trautwein published before we had a chance. But then the folk told me that he doesn't like this, and he wants to have another proof which is geometrically related. So I would tell you the geometry, and I won't tell you the proof. For the proof, if it's correct, you can see this paper. If it's incorrect, then something to do. But there is a bit of a catch here, because if you consider the whole character variety, which is known to be hypercalor, there is a paper of Biswas who proved that, in fact, you can recover your M, the complex structure, from this whole character variety. So at least this cannot work. It's Biswas, Marina Logares, and a couple of other authors, recently actually. So it's like the opposite to what Fock wants. So what they say that you can recover the complex structure, the curve up to a complex automorphism from the hypercalor structure on a character variety.
Up to
you mean hypercalor up to diffeomorphism? Diffeomorphism of what? I'm sorry. You are back in this situation, or you're asking about this? I'm not sure its distinction is meaningful, because already in if you have this hypercalor structure, it is there's no diffeomorphism that fix it. So all diffeomorphisms that fix a hypercalor structure are identity. So it's not like for complex when you have lots of automorphisms fixing a complex structure. Here it's there's no difference, because in hypercalor structure fixes you a canonical connection in each on each hypercalor manifold, and your automorphism have to be compatible with this connection. So it's essentially Riemannian structure and more. It's even bigger than Riemannian structure. And so, but Biswas's result of Biswas is not about Riemannian, it's only about complex structure. He says, okay, hypercalor means that you have three complex structures going around, and these three complex structures are already enough to recover the character variety. The curve from the character variety. Okay. So I'm going back to Fuchsian and quasi-Fuchsian groups. So definition. Oh, before I give the definition, let me tell you something which is pretty nice and important. You have group PSL SL2C, which is actually isomorphic to SO 1, 3, which is the same as isometries of hyperbolic three-space. This is the Möbius group, and this is the hyperbolic isometries. But what is good about that is that you have your, I will call it H, the hyperbolic space, and DH is its boundary, which you can, should I tell more about hyperbolic, or is it known to everybody? Because there is a nice realization of hyperbolic spaces inside, which actually gives this, well, this the last automorphism, which is as follows. You take projectization. You fix a V, real space of with a metric of signature 1, 3. You take projectization of V, and you take positive vectors there. And the group SO of 1, 3 acts on this projectization of positive vectors with stabilizer. SO3, the compact stabilizer. So you can average with this group, and this gives you a unique metric on this space, which is a definition of hyperbolic metric. It's just unique metric on this projectization of positive cone, which is invariant under SO1, 3. And then you have a boundary of this positive cone, V plus, which you can think of it as a quadric, or just you can think of this positive cone as of a ball, and this would be canonically identified with CP1 or with a two-dimensional sphere. And then this group acts here by Möbius transform. This is how you obtain this identification, actually. You just look how this group acts on the boundary, and you check that it is acts by the full group of conformal automorphisms of CP1. Okay. So in particular, this is the boundary of your disk is canonically identified with CP1. Now we can define Fuchsian representation. function. But this is something we already had. Representation of P1 of M is it's P1 of M mapping to projectivization of projective SL to C, which is identified with the hyperbolic group SO13. And this is the you obtain your M as now this is upper half plane two dimensional by its fundamental group, and this you consider automorphisms of upper half plane as a subgroup in Möbius group. This is a natural embedding which people know in from complex analysis. So the upper half plane, it's isometries. So let's write it isometries. Are the same that as this fractional. I mean this Möbius maps with real coefficients. Sorry?
It also has n dimensional.
Yeah. Which one? Okay, yeah. Yeah, you have hyperbolic project, hyperbolic complex hyperbolic space. Yeah, and then you have conformal automorphism of a sphere, which is the same group. Same? Ah, it will be conformal CR automorphisms. Well, thank you. Anyway, so what we have now is this is Fuchsian representation. So the space of Fuchsian representations is the same as the Teichmüller space. I mean, this is how we define it. For each curve, we have a unique weight representing this curve as quotient of upper half plane, and this gives you a representation from here to there. Okay. Now consider any representation. So we have our representation R from pi 1 of n to automorphism of a ball. So it's to SO13, and consider define limit set. Limit set of R is a set of limit points of all R orbits on boundary. I fix this boundary as here. It's CP1. So outside of limit set, the group acts discretely. So for Fuchsian representations, what happens is that upper half, so your CP1 is a union of upper half plane and lower half plane. So CP1 is, you have this upper half plane, H. You have the circle in between, and you have lower half plane, H bar. So here, the group acts discretely. So in particular, there's no limit set on the outside of the boundary. And on the boundary, it clearly acts with dense orbits. So this is the limit set. Now definition. Oh, OK, theorem first. For small deformations of Fuchsian representations, the limit set is a Jordan curve. Jordan curve in the sense that it is a continuous, it's an image of continuous map from a circle to CP1. It typically has very bad Hausdorff dimension, it's bad. It's not smooth. And now definition. Definition. This is all like work of Birth and Alfors from late 50s and early 60s. And now representation R is quasi-function. If the limit set is Jordan curve. No, typically not. Typically it's very fractal, very bad Hausdorff dimension. Is it definition? R is called quasi-function representation if its limit set is Jordan curve. Limit set is this guy, which is limit set of all orbits. So if we think of R, of the group acting on an hyperbolic ball, and we look at orbit at each point, and we take its the limits of the orbits in the boundary. So essentially what happens is that you have discontinuous set of the boundary where your group acts properly, and limit set where it acts very badly, and typically with dense orbits. So for what happens for this Jordan core curves here is that Yeah, precisely. Thank you very much. Quasi is a small neighborhood. Well, not small. In fact, it's sort of really hard to find a representation which is not quasi-function. So quasi-functions, guys, they live somewhere in the limit. They're typically smaller dimension, and it's attained as closure. So people don't study them much for. Yeah, it's an open neighborhood of function inside the character variety. But it's not everything, definitely. There are guys who have, first let me tell you about how it works, and I will tell you some funny examples. Okay, so let me make a picture first. I have this CP1, which is a boundary of our, and now I have this Jordan curve here. It's not Peano curve, but it could be as close as to Peano as possible. So it's Hausdorff dimension can be anything between 1 and 2. Now I have two upper, let's call it H plus and H minus. These are two subsets. I mean, it's upper and lower subset of your CP1. Two subsets where your fundamental group acts discretely. And then you can take a quotient. H plus, quotient by pi 1 of M, and H minus, quotient by pi 1 of M. And the claim is that this quotient is compact, which is sort of clear. But for topological reasons. I mean, it's a deformation of the standard representation. Of course, it's different. Now it's different deformation up and down. They are not the same. But let's give a map. So we have a map from obtain a map. From quasi-function representations to Teichmuller times Teichmuller bar. This is a complex conjugate curve, so it's a complex conjugate representation, so it's really a product with complex conjugate space. This map is holomorphic. And now there is a theorem, a Birth theorem of uniform uniformization. Thank you. the map, let's call it, I don't know how to call it, U. U is isomorphism. So essentially the question, and of course Techmuller sits inside U as a real subspace, subvariety, real the real points. So it's a set of real points, yeah? Thank you very much. Yes, of course. Thanks. Techmuller sits in quasi-Fuchsian maps as a set of real points. So now it becomes very natural to ask what Fuchs did and what Trautwein proved or didn't prove. Is that okay? We have a It's very good. So probably I would, unless you want me to tell, okay, can you tell some funny things about Bayes uniformization? So what happens when this limit set becomes bigger and bigger? At some point, that might happen that there is several components of this of the complement to the limit set. Then you have a map to several copies of Teichmuller space, and this is well defined. And in fact, you can find such a strange points in the character variety, which could provide you several several points in the Teichmuller space. Not two, where you have one-to-one correspondence, but several ones. But then there's strange. This is still not entirely understood, I think. And then in the end, of course, you just cover everything by the limit set, and it becomes completely bizarre. Okay, but what we have here is that this is similar to what happens in hypercardial geometry, and I will finish by telling you about it. So definition, unless there are questions, hypercardial manifold is the following data is M I J K G, where I J K complex structures, G Keller metric. So it's Riemannian metric which is Keller for I J K, and we have quaternion relations. J I times J is equal to minus J times I is equal K. So the point is that you have a, as I told you, what is complex structure? It's just an operator which rotates by 90 degree. So they all act on the tangent space. And this is, now you have quaternion structure on the tangent space, and the Keller condition just means that nabla Levitchian connection of I is equal to nabla of J is equal to nabla of K is equal to zero. This is more or less equivalent to all the integrability data collected. And this is the structure which you have on complex character varieties. So by theorem of Hitchin, the character variety for any complex Lie group. I think you have to have a reductive here. So it's MGC. But in fact, if you look at the proof, you can even do it for some non-reductive. Is hypercardial. But in fact, this is This is structure which naturally arises on any cotangent space. So let me give you, I will state the theorem in the simplest form without functoriality, and then I explain in which sense it is functorial. It's a theorem by Kaledin and Fakes. Sorry? No. Not every hypercalor is a cotangent space. Yeah, so I will now explain how to obtain. Well, characterize all cotangent spaces in a small neighborhood of any. Yeah. Yeah, but of course, globally it's definitely false. And in fact, this theorem is never works for any except U1, for any other semi-simple Lie group, if you want to apply it directly. But it's not about characterize, it's about it's theorem about hypercalor. Structures, how they arise in geometry. So it's Kaledin and Fakes. You have X is scalar. You have a real analytic Keller structure. Then there exist unique in the way which I'm going to specify now, hypercalor structure on a neighborhood of zero in cotangent space of X. So hypercalors are sort of, every time you have something Keller, you can get something hypercalor. And the idea that Fock had is that you start with this Fuchsian groups. You put there identified the Techmuller. Then you should this quasi-Fuchsian groups in a neighborhood of zero. They're identified with cotangent with Techmuller. And then you would have hypercalor structure on this cotangent of Techmuller, which he hopes will be the same as the hypercalor structure on the character variety. So every character variety is hypercalor. Okay.
Sir, what way has hypercalor structure
in I'm going to tell this. Thank you very much. I'm going to tell this now. So there are lots of structures on cotangent variety which we should use for this uniqueness. So first, let's note that if you have hypercalor manifold M, I, J, K, G, the hypercalor, you have three symplectic forms. So omega I, omega J, omega K are Keller symplectic forms. For instance, omega K of alpha beta is equal to G of alpha K beta. This is standard way of you produce, Hermitian form from Hermitian metric. Okay, now we will take the linear combination, omega j plus square of minus 1 omega k on mi. This is holomorphically symplectic. Well, to see that it's homomorphically symplectic, you need only to check that it's complex linear, because every closed closed form, which is type 2 zero, complex linear, is in fact holomorphic. And this is linear algebra. To check this complex linear under I, it's not hard. In fact, the converse is also true. If you have a Keller, compact Keller, holomorphically symplectic manifold, there is a unique hypercalor metric on it. Which induces the whole, the rest of the structures, including the Keller class, unique Keller metric and unique hypercalor metric in the given Keller class. So this is, but this is for compact manifold. For non-compact, there are much more data that are contained in a symplectic structure. So, but at least in that case, what we need is that I the standard complex structure, standard. So it's for Kaledin fields. Theorem, standard complex structure on cotangent of X. So if you have a space, the cotangent complex, the cotangent space is also compact. And then you have omega, which is omega j plus square of minus 1 omega k. This is Hamiltonian symplectic structure. This is not enough for uniqueness. There's another last piece of data for uniqueness. Sorry? Standard. Okay, I won't try to call it Hamiltonian if you don't like it. Standard. Yeah, standard structure on cotangent space of X. Sometimes it's called Hamiltonian. I think it was constructed by Hamilton when he started the whole symplectic business. So what he did, he just wrote one form, and this what is the differential. Okay, so the last piece of data is the following. You have a rotation on the complex rotation on T star of M of X, and it should rotate complex structures of which comes from quaternion, so of form AI plus BJ plus CK. So this data is not enough because there are lots of symplectic forms for non-compact varieties, but this is already strong enough that there will be actually a functorial equivalence between category of Keller manifolds and category of hyper-Keller manifolds with this rotation. So you can even forget that it was cotangent space. It will be cotangent space a posteriori because this rotation would retract your complex manifold to its zero section of the cotangent bundle. Okay, so I have like 5 minutes, right? So I just wanted to say that how you can apply this to character varieties, because character varieties has precisely this kind of action, and then they are example of this kind of fixed space, but of course only in the neighborhood of fixed points of this action. So the idea is that you have if you have such an action on a hyper-Keller manifold, and the fixed points are like half-dimensional, they're attracted, everything is attracted to the attraction fixed points, then it is a cotangent space in that sense. So in particular, if we find such an action on the character variety, we are done, and there is a holomorphic action of this type on character variety, which is actually how it was obtained, how the hypercalor structure was obtained by Simpson. So he said that suppose you have G is a compact Lie group, GC is a complexification. Then you can have, it is well known from old works of Narasim Hansis. No, it's not, it's Ramagul, Indian. So that the space of G bundles on M is a complex variety. And then GC bundles, this is our character variety, are the same as cotangent bundle to this space of G bundles. So it's to character variety of M G. And this is actually true for all so this is cotangent space in a neighborhood, in a neighborhood of this character variety. This is actually true for any Kähler manifold M, and it was Hitchin who proved it for curve, for Riemann surface, but it is true for any Kähler manifold. Of course, in our case, the problem is that our the analog of the same as flat connection. So flat. But they are flat a posteriori if you fix the holomorphic structure. They exist and they remain stable. They are unique. There is a unique flat connection respecting this holomorphic structure. So it's, you just identify the space of G bundles with the corresponding space of holomorphic bundles. This is how it is. How you obtain this complex structure, and then you use Simpson approach to identify this whole thing with the cotangent space and your It's bigger, so it's about neighborhood.
Sorry?
It's about neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Precisely. This is what I'm saying. But what is more interesting is that hypercalor structure is obtained by this functorial procedure, which is... So I just wanted to explain why one would expect Fox conjecture to be true. Because now we have, instead of this space of G bundles with compact structure group, we have our Teichmuller space, which also sits inside of the space of inside the character variety, the same half dimension. It's the same. It's not hard to see that even the symplectic structure from character variety, the Hitchin symplectic structure restricted to this Teichmuller, would be the same always. So it's sort of natural to expect that the same would be true. And this is what actually Trautwein claimed, that you obtain, using Kalinin fix, you just obtain that Teichmuller space. Yeah, it's in a certain neighborhood. It's a germ. It's even hypercalor identification. So it's germ of in both cases. Fix, yeah. They're the same, yeah. So the idea was to apply the same, but replacing this character variety by the Teichmuller space, which sits in all by this theorem of Bertz uniformization sits as a real subvariety in all in the space of quasi-Fuchsian representations. Okay, I wanted to tell the proof, but I suppose there's no time, so thank you very much. Oh, it was something I just missed very told very briefly. You have a very interesting limit sets with where you have not two open subsets where your group acts properly, but infinitely many, and they are all identified again by the group action. In the end, what you obtain is that you have the map not to the product of two Tachmiller spaces, but a map to several Tachmiller spaces. This is something where you lose all hypercalid business because it's now dimension is bigger, but you still have some control over your quasi-Fuchsian or no longer quasi-Fuchsian representations. And you can go further and further. There's lots of very beautiful works on that were still going on, so it's still sort of active part of math. It properly should be drawn, but you can imagine, like you have lots of small open sets which are exchanged, and they're more and more open, and it's like a Swiss cheese with infinitely many holes. And all these holes are curves on the boundary of your hyperbolic space. Yeah. I think so, yeah. It's something that Fock mentioned.